women were slaves to a system worse than death, they scoffed at the sickly sentimentality which proposes to punish nobody, which proposes to hang nobody, which proposes to let all the unchained passions of the human heart become free to prey upon mankind. What nonsense, Eliza R. Snow exclaimed from the platform of the old tabernacle. She and other leaders among Salt Lake City women had acted quickly to organize what they called an indignation meeting. And actually, that was a well-recognized and popular form of protest in the 19th century, kind of like picketing the White House or parading downtown. The idea was to generate publicity, and it almost always worked. The newspapers claimed that this was, you know, ridiculous. How could anybody defend polygamy? But they published whole pages giving the speeches, some of them verbatim. So they got a lot of publicity. We can't draw strict cause and effect. The Cullen Bill did fail. Other more draconian measures came later, but it took a while. But Utah women organized indignation meetings in 52 towns and communities around Utah, claiming with, I think, considerable exaggeration that 25,000 people attended those. There were about 100,000 people in Utah at the time, so they probably were exaggerating. But they did make a big fuss in the paper. And then it got even more exciting. A few days after the indignation meeting, the Utah legislature sort of capped off this whole publicity campaign by passing legislation granting Utah women the right to vote. Now, a few weeks before, the territory of Wyoming had given women the right to vote. And Wyoming is justly recognized as the first nation, the first territory in the United States to do that, but there were 10 times as many men as women in Wyoming at the time, and very few of either. It was a brand new territory, and there were indeed more than 100,000 people in Utah, so it was much more massive action, and roughly 50-50 in terms of the adult population of males and females. And it was so startling, the spectacle in Utah, that people began to rethink, I mean, what is going on here? How possibly could you put polygamy, or plural marriage, as the Mormons call it, together with female suffrage? There's no question, however, that the women in the indignation meeting were standing up for the peculiar marriage system. And one of them went so far as to say, if Congress imprisoned Mormon men, they would have to make their jails big enough to include the women too, because where the men went, the wives would follow. So this gathered a lot of attention from people on all sides of the political spectrum, including the women who had begun to pressure Congress and had first managed to get a proposed legislation, which was laughed away, into Congress to grant women in the United States the vote. And those included Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony. And they had been planning a trip to the West. And so the next summer, when they undertook that trip, they added Utah to the agenda. It was really rather fascinating that when the press talked to Elizabeth Cady Stanton about the question, she said that antagonists on the Mormon question had missed the entire point. Polygamy and monogamy were both oppressive systems. She suggested that those who opposed the Latter-day Saints were every bit as befuddled as the saints themselves. The condition of women is slavery today and must be for as long as they are shut out of the world of work, helpless dependence on man for bread. So this was the beginning. It's a complicated story, but this was the beginning of a long-standing alliance between national women's rights leaders in the United States and polygamous wives who were leaders within their own community. On again, off again, touchy, difficult alliance, because, you know, maybe there was the only thing more disreputable than Mormonism was women's rights in this period. I mean, they were allies. We look back at them today and we see one group as in the vanguard of the future, and the other group is sort of caught in some strange Old Testament system. But what's wonderful about history is the way it surprises us and forces us to think some really interesting questions. How could it be possible that the same group of women could be ardent defenders of women, the women's rights to vote, and the women's rights agenda, and at the same time embrace this peculiar Mormon system? At one level, I think the answer is absolutely obvious. Women responded in the indignation meeting defending plural marriage because their community was threatened. They were not only women, they were Latter-day Saints. And they were not going to abandon their own sons, husbands, and fathers when they're under attack from the federal government. It's intersectionality, those of you who are studying women history, we know that. That gender is only one category of analysis. And in this case, religion comes into play, and it's certainly something that I see every day of the week among some of my students who are Muslims. I mean, people look at some of these fabulous young women and say, why are you wearing that headscarf? Because I'm a Muslim, and I'm proud of it. And I'm also an advocate for women's freedom and women's rights and women's education. So in some sense, I think that's an explanation, but it's a simple, too simple explanation. If an Eastern movement sort of ignited a spark that took fire in Utah as a women's rights movement, the fuel for that fire had been accumulating for years, and a spark ignited it. Utah may have looked like an old world patriarchy with its biblical terminology, its theocratic government, and its retreat into a valley that actually had a Dead Sea at one end and a freshwater lake at the other, connected by a river that they obviously named the River Jordan. But the people who had migrated to Utah in the late 1840s and early 50s had been touched by the radical energies of the 1830s and 40s that had disrupted things all over the Western world. By the time the Mormons arrived in Utah, female as well as male leaders knew how to circulate petitions, sign affidavits, lobby public officials, and employ the power of the press. And by embracing Mormonism, the leaders of the indignation meeting have already shown a willingness to push against the grain. Some had abandoned homes, families, and legal husbands in order to do so. They had been Methodists, Quakers, Anglicans, Campbellites, and everything in between. As Latter-day Saints, they had experimented with health reform, dress reform, and communitarianism. Some practiced, even if they did not yet preach, something called sex radicalism was the idea that you choose your own marriage partner and you could leave it if he didn't treat you well or make you happy. Their indignation emerged from religious passion, from a yearning for millennial justice, from the experience of being hounded and driven from place to place, and from the frustration of vainly petitioning judges, governors, and presidents for redress. But there's one more element.